Hello. Hello, and welcome to the illusion of magic. I'm Doug Henning, and I'm here to do some magic tricks for you. Hocus pocus, wocus locust. It's magic, it's all an illusion. Let's see who we have on the telephone here. I believe we have someone calling. Oh. Let's try that again. Dan, calling for a show. It's magic. It's an illusion. Let's see what he has to say now. David who?
David Copperfield.
David Copperfield? Are you involved with magic?
Why, of course. I've been on many television shows for the last 35 years.
I've never even heard of you. Have you heard of me? I am Doug Henning, the illusionist of magic. I heard you hang out with that old president of ours, George Bush Sr. Yeah.
Yes.
How did you guys come to meet yourselves?
Well, let me see. As an illusionist, I...
You made his wife disappear, I heard.
Why, yes. And replaced her with a sentinel.
A sentinel? What would you replace a wife with a sentinel for? So, David, I heard you tell this joke to the president. Well, how does the joke go?
What's the famous illusionist called?
Oh, it would be Doug Henning.
No, it's David Copperfield.
I'm disgusted by that. I'm deeply offended by that. That's gross. You tell that to people? That's disgusting. I'm going to hang up right now. This is just... Do you know who I am? I'm Doug Henning, and I've been doing this for a long time. I do illusions, and I don't have time for this. It's disgusting. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to pull a disappearing act, and I'm going to pull into a little new magic. This is the kind of magic I'm used to.
Sagan, what do you want? What could you possibly want, Carl Sagan?
Why? I feel sort of like we need some movement.
Sideways down. Oh, my. this point. I'm pretty much a staple of this Peasant Revolution Band Variety Hour show. I mean, you know, I think people might be just a tiny bit disappointed if they tune in and they don't see me doing a commercial for Safford Brothers Downtown Blend Taste City Coffee. You know, they're going to be like, where's Sid? You know, so here I am again. And you know, it's weird. You know, it's one of these things where I used to eat a lot of crunchy Raisin Bran cereal, you know, and I'm drinking so much coffee that I barely eat anything, you know? And I guess that's pretty cool. I mean, you know, I maintain my weight and I just do what I got to do because I really do enjoy that flavor, that taste, and that coffee, the Safford Brothers Downtown Blend Taste City Coffee, just always hits the spot. It's delicious.
And we're back. We're back. Welcome, everybody, to the Peasant Revolution Band Variety Hour. I'm your host, Jeff Dodge. And what we like to do is we like to bring people from all walks of life to join us in this sort of a television interview format. But it's different because we're streaming across the internet. So it's not television, and there's no FCC requirements, as far as I know of right now. Speaking of which, we have with us the commander on harmonica, the bassist Steven Sabila, and of course, Rockin' Rich Reese at the drum set, running the whole thing.
That's
how
right.
How are you, Rich?
I'm great, Jeff. I can't say enough for how I'm doing right now.
Is it? I heard you've been traveling around the world.
Well, not that far around the world. We stayed in the Western Hemisphere and the Northern Hemisphere, actually.
Was that the Primus trip, or?
Oh, no, well, that was all the way out to East County, or as my shrink likes to call it, East Jesus.
East Jesus.
Yeah, that was out at the little place, I don't know if you've been, it's called Edgefield.
Okay, really?
Yeah, and
I've never been to the Edgefield show yet.
I had been to a concert there in well over a decade. I can see why people who aren't from here just go absolutely nuts when they see a place like that.
Really? I mean, if you're from here, you don't go as nuts.
That's right. I mean, do you ever go to Kennedy School and just pretend you're not from here?
Yes, every time. The service would make me really frustrated if I was from
here. But just find, you know, imagine if you were in Indiana and you found a place like that. You'd think it was fantastic, right? I mean, here, you know, it's just this place. It's owned by these guys from Beaverton who are getting rich off of the subsidies for the, you know, the vintage buildings. So we just, you know, we don't allow ourselves to enjoy it. But if you were from Phoenix or something and you stumbled across a place like that, well, I think, you know, you'd think it was pretty great.
Well, I don't really remember spending much time in Phoenix, but Jamila and I were just traveling through, what was that town by Flagstaff or something?
Oh.
I could see them really getting into the Kennedy School.
Yeah.
Those people. It was a John Wayne tribute they had at this one restaurant with the big steaks. Remember that?
Oh.
Kingman, that's what it was. Kingman, Arizona would be a huge fan of the McMinimums. My mother, who was a guest recently, apparently went to school with the McMiniman brothers.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay.
Yeah. Grade school or something like that.
What I have heard is that they don't suffer from an excess of humility.
Yeah, she apparently, her and her sister were staying at the Gearhart one, I guess one of them was there, and he got angry at them and was banging on the wall next to them.
Oh.
And they, of course, kept laughing and giggling and creating more chaos.
Certainly.
Which is where that comes from for me, if anyone's wondering.
Well, maybe he got one of his own, like, sort of skunky beers. Like, and that just pissed him off because now he knows how half the customers
that
feel.
Beer is, yes. Ruby is not bad, but yeah, there's.
Yeah.
Anyways, the McMiniman's a great establishment. And
yeah.
After McMiniman's and the.
And if they're watching.
The old Crazy Farm, wasn't it?
It was the old Poor Farm previously. So, like, back before we had Social Security and stuff like that, that's where sound guys would go to retire.
Okay. Right, so. Right. It's such a bummer because we have nowhere to go now.
That's true. I mean, I got a house for Scott. Obviously, I got room for him at my place.
Well, that would be very generous of you, considering that would be your fourth or fifth time now.
Yeah, I got a couple of people who are running on their third time. Actually, you know what? Katie just moved in, so I've got...
How is that going?
That's okay. Yeah, she's got this... You know, what really turned the tables on this one is she got this gig editing the new biography of Vicatia. And so
right. Yes.
After that happened, I ran her credit again and determined that she finally qualified to actually move in. So
a qualified renter.
Yep. And she's now she's got local presence now. No, absolutely. You can't trust.
Jamila does a credit check on me every year.
I bet. Yeah. Yeah. She probably has Stu hand the schedule over and determine whether or not you need to put a deposit down again. But
well, no, the thing I have with Dad's a different deal. But,
oh.
Owe him some, and I owe a few people things. But, you know, you go into debt to make these things happen.
Well,
like
that's
Trench Digger Productions.
And I think that's why we started doing this show, right? Was
that's
to kind of help you crawl out of some of that.
It was way cheaper to do this than to actually go to all the energy of bringing the music to people. We just bring the people to the energy, and it's all on the internet and things like that. We have a great show today, by the way. But...
Yeah.
Before I get into that, I did want to ask you about the real trip. You were in Norway,
right.
Is that right?
Yeah, I went over to Norway with some family, and we drove around.
Have you been there before?
I had not been there before. You know, it is an immensely expensive place to exist.
Okay, Jamila's Norwegian,
taste
is probably...
Well, I'm like 12/5 Norwegian, we've determined, so... Except, of course, Reese is not Norwegian, but... you guys should take a trip over there sometime.
It's
just fantastic.
An Irish Viking kind of thing.
Okay.
But we've been watching The Vikings, a wonderful TV show out there.
Sure.
Have you seen that at all?
No, but I've heard it's a
Ragnar Lothbrok.
Oh, sure. So I've heard about that. It sounds like a tremendous show.
Is there a lot of Ragnar homages there?
Not really. You know, I mean, the most probably impressive thing, and this is coming, you know, as an Oregonian. They have a lot of trees, and they don't have as many clear cuts as we do.
You know, they're probably a few hundred years behind the evolutionary thinking that
they're just doing all this oil extraction a little bit to the south. That's probably why they're not harvesting as many as maybe they could. But, you know,
IKEA harvest a lot of wood? Or?
Well, that's Sweden. And I think
Swedes.
They pull a lot of that from the, from some less advantaged countries. But driving around, you know, we went into Bergen and just started cruising around. We wanted to go to these old places where the family members were from. And so we're driving around in the outskirts. And my nephew and I both noticed the same thing, is that it's driving around there, it's kind of like driving around Oregon, but on steroids. So if you can imagine, like, if you've ever driven from, like... Well, no, just like you've got... So the fjords... you know, they all have roads along the sides of them and then all these big hills. It's kind of like if you've ever driven on, you know, 126 from Eugene to Florence, or if, or even just like if you go over to Tillamook on Highway 6 and you go up and through the hills and then you come down and then you're in that valley where there's little water and there's cows and all that stuff. It's like that, but everything's way, way bigger and grander. And the roads are immaculate.
Really?
Yeah. And I know some of our viewers out there, I know we have some people who swing ride, and they're going to say, well, I heard the tax rate's a whole lot higher over there, so the people are suffering. I actually looked it up while I was over there. I looked at the average versus median net worth of individuals in Norway, and it's kind of complex, but their average net worth is lower than ours, but their median net worth is higher than ours, which means they have...
States or Oregon?
United States. And so what that means is they have less to go around, but they do a better job of distributing it.
Right.
So they don't have as much to give out to their people, but they give out more to their people.
Right.
And their super rich end up doing just fine.
I see.
So, yeah.
You know, yeah, I've heard of things like that happening. Not in this country, but there was this country that had this, I think his name was Roosevelt or something like that. And
I don't know what you're talking about.
They had a high tax system, and it worked pretty good. And they took care of their people.
Well,
I can't remember what country that was.
You got all these motherfuckers wearing crosses talking about the old days, you know, the good old days, like the 50s
and
stuff. And it's like, well, okay, well, do you want to go back to, like, the 90% tax rate on rich people? Because that's what it took. And they're like, no, we don't want to do that.
No,
like, well, do you want to go back to, you know, better schools? No, we don't want to do that. You know, go back to higher union membership. Turns out all they miss is segregated restaurants.
Right.
That is what they're talking about for the good old days.
We learned that the private sector really does take care of everyone, you know?
Yeah, you just
need the streets.
let the market sort it out, and then you hide all the losers.
I'm ready for horse-drawn carriages again.
Really, hey, that's not a terrible idea.
A horse-drawn carriage.
You know, a great conservative once said, "Would you rather die of cancer at 80 or typhoid fever at 9 from the horse-drawn carriages?" And I think the way my life's gone, I probably could go from the typhoid at 9. But
I'd split the difference, like traumatic shock death at 33 or something.
Oh, that's
like that.
Pretty. You know who Gun else died at 33? It's this guy. He had some kind of weird ideas and long hair and wore sandals.
Like a hippie dude, right? I've heard about him, the Buddha or something like that.
Wouldn't even keep all the fish to himself.
Yeah, and did great things with wine. He could make wine out of anything.
He'd piss those bartenders off, though. He'd show up and just ask for a glass of water.
Right.
And then
rips everyone off. I mean, someone was taking a cut on that Paul or something like that.
Oh, Paul, according to my girlfriend's dissertation, it would be Paul to take the cut on that one. He was the one that basically invented.
We have a wonderful show for you tonight. Skye Stouber is our guest. He comes to us with great art in his heart and a performance to blow our minds, because we're still working on the song here, but hopefully he'll be able to perform to it, and it should be really fun. But first, let's get to know Skye. We're going to take a quick commercial and bring out Skye Stouber right after this break. Stay tuned and don't miss the Peasant Revolution Band Variety Hour with Jeff Dodge.
Vladimir's Epidermis Emporium. That's right, our epidermis is showing. Surrender to your innermost desires. The most beautiful epidermis you ever can hope to see. The best, most well-oiled, finest lotions having been applied. Our epidermis offers a feast for your eyes, and the best epidermis you will ever see, as well as the most epidermis you can ever hope to see. Enjoy the sensual beauty of Vladimir's Epidermis Emporium. Surrender.
And we're back without a further delay. Ladies and gentlemen, Skye Stouber in the house. Wow, what an exciting moment we have here. Skye, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? Who is Skye Stouber?
I'm actually Theodore Skye Stouber, so I'll start off with that. I'm a Portland native.
Oh,
yeah.
Yes.
Ballet dancer. Dancer extraordinaire.
What got you into dance?
My parents told me it would make me a better baseball player.
Oh, so you started with baseball. What ages were you doing that?
Started playing baseball when I was about 6, Little League, T-ball. And then I started dancing when I was 12.
Okay, so 6 years of baseball, and then you find dance come to you.
Yes.
And what was the first musical kind of thing? Was it a song, or was it a performance, or was it the whole spiel that said, I want to do that?
Well, I guess I always liked dancing. My mom's Nicaraguan, so I grew up around a lot of Latin music. Clave, you know.
What is clave? That's an instrument,
it's,
right?
It's an instrument, but also a rhythm. It's ba, 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 ba.
Right. Is samba, is that the same kind of thing?
Similar. And I also grew up on a lot of Andean folk music, believe it or not.
Wow.
And one of my favorite ballets. Actually done to Inti Illimani.
So had your mom introduced a lot of this to you as a young child then? So this was always kind of around you?
It was always around. I think I always liked music and always wanted to move my body, but I never really started seriously or training until I was a little bit older.
What part of Portland did you grow up in?
Southwest, Multnomah Village.
Okay. And I guess our bass player Steve knows you from some incidents.
Said Wilson, maybe.
Wilson High School, is that correct?
Briefly.
Where did you end up at?
Well, after my freshman year of high school, I dropped out, and I went to go to the Houston Ballet School and then the San Francisco Ballet School.
Oh, so you went pro leagues done with that. I have a friend of mine, Paul West. Oh, Rich.
just like Tanya Harding.
Tanya Harding, did she drop out of high school?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know, Stu did sound for a Tanya Harding gig and met her mother.
Oh.
And she yelled at him.
I bet she did.
Tape. But I did. Yeah. That's did you ever meet Tanya Harding?
Not yet.
There's still time. She's still out there. And just got a big movie. Well, okay. Yep. Moving forward. So, you, what year was it you decided you were done with that and you wanted to step it up and follow this path?
There are big ballet companies all around the country: New York City, Seattle, San Francisco, Houston, Chicago. Every summer, they have a big little summer camp for all the kids to come to, and then they recruit you out of there. A good friend of mine and I went up to Seattle, auditioned for all of the biggest companies, and got full scholarships to all of them, which we did not expect. And it kept happening and happening. And we were like, okay, well, I guess this is serious. Went to New York City that summer, came back, and wanted nothing to do with academics any longer. And so I struggled through that 1 year of high school and then just got out.
Man, it took me 8 years to figure that out. I was... That's another story. Well, what were the early years like then? When did you get out of onto your own? About 18, do you go travel with a troupe at that point, or what were some of those experiences early on? Did you go on tours of the country and the world, or just the country?
Well, so starting off, you just go into school. It was a pre-professional program. You know, 16. Wake up, dance for 8 hours a day, you dance with the professional company. Did that for a while, but I actually only made it until I was 18, then I hurt my knee, and I've only just started dancing again in the past year. So, no touring for me. I just signed my first professional contract at 23, which is a little later than I had expected.
So you're actually 23 right now. Oh, he's such a kid, such a kid. This is great. Will you do a little dance for us if we try and play some pre-prepared music for you? We're going to go to a commercial break, and we're thinking we'd check out a routine if you're into that. Is that all right?
That sounds good to me.
Awesome, Skye. Skye Stouber is going to perform for us as soon as we come back. Stand by, everybody, and we'll be right back after this important message.
Lettuce. It's the cornerstone of any great salad. Fresh and delicious. Remarkable. Really good. Larry's lettuce is homegrown and full of goodness from the sunshine and the crystal clean waters of the Pacific Northwest. Taste the difference, and you'll never go back. Look for Larry's Lettuce wherever you buy produce. It's lettuce so good that you'll think you're eating it straight out of the garden.
Thank you. Let's take a quick break and we'll be right back. We're back with Skye Stouber. Wow, that was fantastic.
Thank you.
What kind of themes were you playing with for that performance?
That was an excerpt of a dance that I won't name for copyright purposes.
Your copyright or? Do you have some original dances though that you're working on or?
I do have one. It's more of a video composition, but I haven't done too much of making my own work just yet, no.
Okay, so this was inspired by others, okay.
More of a recreator or a canvas. People tell me what to do, and then I do it.
Yes. Who were some of the artists that have influenced your style?
Well, starting off, I was really into classical ballet, so you got Baryshnikov and Nureyev and Alicia Alonso and all the old guard, but more recently it's been more modernist works. I just discovered what postmodernism is. Don't worry, I don't care for it. But Pina Bausch, Alejandro Cerruto, Yuri Killian, European names.
Nice. Yeah. So this piece was a recreation of others, sort of an amalgamy of things. Is there any of your mother's influence with the Nicaraguan background? Did that come into this particular piece, or do you use it in other elements?
Probably other elements. I think it comes out whenever anyone asks me to dance, kind of what's in me. That's buried very deep, so that always that's always there.
What, now, do you visit Nicaragua, or have you gone there before? Or?
I have been, not lately. There's a little bit of unrest, a lot of unrest.
What do you know about that? Because I remember growing up when I was a young kid and there was all this U.S. stuff going on. Is that still kind of part of the colonial thing going on? Or?
Well, I believe the socialists overthrew the fascists, supported by the United States government.
Was that Ortega, right?
It is Ortega. And it's still Ortega. That's
okay.
The thing.
Okay.
And his wife is vice president. So they've been in power.
That's like 40 years?
Yeah, 40 years. My mom was actually growing up there during the Sandinistas and the...
The Contras.
So very recently, there's been a lot of violence, but up for a few years, it was pretty cool there.
So there was a moment then. Because when I'm so old, that they used to teach social studies before they realized that'll create critical thinkers, and they don't want that, so... Back when I was young, they had all this El Salvador and Nicaragua conflict going on and sort of skirting around how we were exactly involved. But did it start the conflict in El Salvador or did it start in Nicaragua?
I couldn't tell you my history on that, on the very beginnings of the conflict.
You were not born yet, and I was a sixth grade going, what is this? I want my Ranger Rick. But, okay, well, we'll leave it at that. So it's not so hot a spot to vacation right now, but you still have family there, I take it?
Yes, a little bit, yeah.
And what is what are some of the musical and ballet, I remember Mexico had ballet folklorica, mm-hmm. with the big dresses and that kind of dance. Is there any of that kind of sense that affects Nicaraguan ballet?
Well, I think the ballet folklorico is actually, I don't know the etymology of it, but it doesn't necessarily correlate with classical European ballet. It's sort of a dance, a word to describe the dance. I'm not terribly familiar with the classic style of dance of Nicaragua, I think.
But there was a European influence there too, the Spanish.
Yes, I mean, salsa, bachata, merengue, but I think bachata is a little more Mexican, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, the cumbia and what's the other one? Cha-cha-cha, that kind of thing. Sabor.
Wow. Great. Oh, I love it. Okay, and now you're 23. Seems like it was all only a few years ago. Here you are, you're making your comeback. And what are you looking forward to in the future as far as what kind of, is there any local Portland area troops you're working with or interested in working with?
In 2 weeks, I'll start with Oregon Ballet Theater. So it's the ballet, basically the ballet company of Portland. We have a couple of, we got like 6 or 7 shows in our season. It runs through next June. I did a performance with them in Alice in Wonderland. It was pretty cool and trippy in February. As I was telling your wife, I missed a costume change and fell on my face, and they still hired me. So must have done something right. But
you fell on cue, I guess.
No, I fell on my knee that I'd injured.
Oh, no!
Actually.
No!
Now, with that knee injury, what is it? Was it an ACL? Or?
Patellar tendon. Started off as tendonitis, and then being the young kid that I was, I wanted to push through it, and then it turned chronic, and then it still hurts, but, you know.
I can tell you, if you've done the right things, it will get better. It's after 40 that the gravity really sets in. That's my experience, but you got tons of years ahead of you, kid. I swear. Have you you're starting with them in a couple weeks then? Okay, and what other kinds of hobbies are you into? Cooking or. What kind of cooking?
I used to cook when I was in school in San Francisco, and I hurt myself originally. I started cooking for my roommates. I used to bake a lot of bread, experiment with Latin flavors, delved into a little light curing of meats. I just recently bought a 12-pound jamón serrano.
What is that?
It's a cured pork leg, and I gave it to my girlfriend for her birthday. And me, for her birthday.
Yourself and the pork leg.
Yes.
How? Yeah, we can't turn
that
down.
The charcuterie is the interest. Can't get too much. Yeah.
Exactly. Well, I think we're kind of interested in maybe rifling through a tune here, if you guys.
Yeah, we could do that.
Do you like the Police? I mean the band, not the officers that serve this fine city, but there was a band called the Police. It's probably a little before your time, with this guy named Sting. Wait, did you have some comments about that, David? Sting? We might come back to that, but Sting. Sting was this guy that, you know, he's a pretty good singer, but he's really good at tantric sex too.
Yo, break it out, EO Sting. No?
EO Sting?
Yeah, no, I mean
Yo. Oh, yeah.
He's great at that.
He's also, you know, he's on Dire Straits tune, Money for Nothing.
Well, and I was going to say, that song and that video, when he came out and did that at Live Aid, it was the first time I found out you could, like, do a song differently than was recorded. I'd never heard of that before. I was like, wow, that's a totally different version. It goes something like this. Something like
Money for Nothing.
was just like the record. Just like the record.
Yeah, this is a tasty fish. It's brined in like a brand name soy sauce and cheap white wine, cheap sugar, salt, little herbs in there, and you know, it's brined overnight. You know, let it dry out and form a nice little pellicle, they call it in the biz. You know, nice sort of protective skin on the membrane, and you know, then we'll smoke it for hours on end and just drink beer and wait. Line cod, barbless hook. Smoking to dry it out, give it a little smoky flavor. Door to door, boat to boat, free range line cod, barbless hooked Chinook.
We're back. We're back. Oh, it's so fun. We've got Skye in the house, and he's volunteered to show this old dog some new tricks. So, Skye, please show me what can I do to get into ballet shape.
Okay. Well, first you got to start with a quick hamstring stretch.
Okay.
I want to do an active stretch rather than a passive stretch. I know you're a little warmed up, but ideally you want to stretch the muscles while you're using them, rather than using a static object. So we're just going to bend down and touch our toes.
Okay.
Just to start, because they are, your hamstrings are holding you up.
You can bend your knees.
Oh, no, your knees are
straight. Don't bend your knees.
Knees are straight, and you just bend over, and you just touch your toes.
Oh, my God!
You stick your head between your feet, like so.
Jeez, I don't think
that's perfect.
Oh, Lordy. I don't think I've done that since I was 7. All right.
Now we'll go into another step called a passe. It's a position.
Passe.
It's a classical ballet position
where
you take one leg and you go to the side and you point your toe and you put it like this by your knee.
That's the passe.
This is the passe, and then you come into first position.
Okay.
So you can hold my hand, actually. We have a bar for support, so you can.
There
you go. That's the passe.
I just do that.
There you go.
There it is.
And then you take your hands and you go like this, and that's a passe in first position. There you go. That's it.
With your hands down like
just,
this.
And then you might go to fifth position with your arms
fifth?
All the way.
David, are you getting this? I'm doing fifth position
right
now.
Yes, that's fifth position.
Oh, this is wonderful. I think I can do this.
The next thing we're going to do to work on our flexibility, you take your hand, heel of your hand.
Okay.
Your foot.
Same foot.
And you just take it all the way out here. So you're just going to take your legs straight.
Whoa. Do that again.
And you're going to take it straight, and you're going to straighten both legs.
Isn't there an age limit on that? All right. I'm going to try it.
You probably need to take a little support there. Yep. You just straighten everything at this point.
Oh!
You know, you're right. There was an age limit on that one, actually. I forgot to mention.
I used to play some hoops. I felt this before. This is a groin pull, I think. We're going to come right back. We'll be right back. Ow! Oh, my God.
Pay some bills. Time to pay some bills.
Been a pleasure having you here. I was told by Steve that when we were one of your earliest childhood memories involves the Portland Trailblazers. Do you want to describe that a little?
Well, was it 99 and 2000, Steve?
It was basically 91 to 2000.
My record. The Kobe and Shaq beating the Blazers in the Western Conference Finals had a little dial TV. Uh-huh. It was color, but there were only 12 channels on it. Watching them beat the Blazers is one of the first things I remember.
Wow. Yeah. That was... I have two memories of the Blazers getting beaten by the Lakers. There was that horrible 2001. But there was also another one in 91. Do you fellas remember that? It was Magic Johnson's team.
Uncle Cliffy.
Divots, and they he finger-rolled the ball out of bounds. Do you remember that? And time went off the clock, and they won, and then they went on to give Chicago their first title. But that was the year we would have had home court. We had like 60 wins out here or something like that. Anyways, that's the first L.A. tragedy. But then the one you remember is when they wouldn't, you know, they call it one way on Sabonis and just let Shaq bowl him over. That final quarter is, I guess if you want to know more about this, if you Google... fourth quarter meltdown, this game will probably come up.
I haven't Googled it myself, but I imagine if you did, that it probably would.
I have. It comes right up. Comes right up. Who were your favorite players on that team?
Arvydas Sabonis. Scottie Pippen. Didn't know he was a Bull. No one ever told me. But growing up, he was one of my favorite players.
You're kidding me. You thought he was a Blazer. It was wow.
Mike Piazza also thought he was a Met. Apparently he's a Dodger. I didn't know. I invited him to my bar mitzvah, actually.
Well, that's great. Oh, so you're Jewish and Nicaraguan.
Jew-Spanic.
Now, what is that experience like? Is that come, were both your parents that way, or is that one's the other? And so that must be an exciting time for the families get together.
Yeah. Yeah, my dad's from Brooklyn, Long Island. My mom's from, obviously from Nicaragua. She let him raise us Jewish. My bar mitzvah was the last time I actually ever went to a synagogue, though.
Well, I hear that's kind of normal. A lot of times Catholics baptism's all we get, you know. I was personally burned out on the first confession, but you probably saw a little bit of that on the Nicaraguan side, right?
No, I think my mom was raised Baptist, but... No religion ever permeated that, but it actually turns out a hotbed of modern dance is in Israel now, so I'm considering rediscovering my faith in the...
Can you do dual citizenship with that?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I can. Yeah.
Oh, I see an angle. That's great. Well, Skye, it has been wonderful having you. Is there anything people should be looking forward to, aside from you joining the ballet in the next couple weeks here? Is there any upcoming shows or events you want to promote?
Yeah, I'll just say a few. Body Box, Northwest Dance Project, Oregon Ballet Theater, PDX Contemporary Dance, all great local dance troupes to keep your eyes out for.
Cool, and we'll put some links that you recommend into the syndicated version, as the word I was going to call, the syndicated broadcast. But as we wind things down here, this is kind of the time of the hour where we didn't really get to do this last month because I was too busy thinking about the class of 1988, which is what I graduated from, and it's our 30th anniversary this year, and we didn't really have a party. You're looking at it. This is the party. We had a great 20th, and we thought we'd leave it at that. But, you know, I also like at this part of the show, like to kind of, you're talking about Ortegas and how they run things. This Wheeler guy that's our mayor right now, he kind of reminds me of a young Danny Ortega, I have to say. He's got this pie in the sky image about how things are gonna work. He's got this.
Yeah.
Oh, hey, it's my lovely wife Jamila. Hi, honey. What's up?
Hey, say goodnight, Jeff.
Oh. All right. Goodnight, Jeff. 2, 3, 4.